Good morning, everybody. Welcome to this very interesting invited talk calling a moving diagnostic monitoring and a therapeutic device onto and into the body, which will be presented by Professor Walter Sedain. Walter Sedain is from Delft University of Technology, the Netherlands, and he's also a IEEE fellow and a mentor of IEEE. He is a co-editor and co-author of several books, and also authored and co-authored about 6 book chapters and more than 250 scientific publications and presentations. He teaches circuit theory, analog signal processing, micropower, analog IC design, and bioelectricity. He received the Electrical Engineer Best Teacher Award in 2001 and 2004. He has served as a technical program chair of IEEE BioCAS 2010 and a technical program chair of IEEE ISCAS 2010 and 2012. As a member of board of government of the IEEE Circuit and System Society, as a chair of the Analog Processing Technical Committee of the IEEE Circuit and System Society, as a member of Steering Committee of IEEE Transaction on Biomedical Circuit and System, and an Editor-in-Chief for IEEE Transaction on Circuit and System 1. He will also be a General Co-Chair for IEEE BioCAS in 2013, and a co-chair of the IEEE ISCAS 2014, and general co-chair of IEEE ISCAS 2015. His research interests include low voltage, ultra-low power, and ultra-wideband analog integrated circuit for wireless communication, pacemakers, cochlear implants, portable, wearable, implantable and injectable, EXG recorders, and neurostimulators. So, Walter, thank you very much for coming. And have a nice presentation.
Thank you very much, Sandro, for the very nice but also quite long introduction. Yes, I guess I have been doing quite a lot in the framework of IEEE and also teaching and research. I'm currently leading a group in which I have 12 PhD students and a number of MSc students, so that will definitely keep me busy and I will not have a boring life. This talk will hopefully give you a visionary view in the future, but also will give you ways to make that future possible. What I would like to do, of course, I will concentrate on the things that I know best, and these are the activities that I'm doing in my own biomedical electronics group at Delft. So there we are working on trying to treat people by means of electricity. And the reason for that is that I'm not an expert in sensors. I only come into action when the signal is in the electrical domain. Then I know what to do. But fortunately, the body, as we will see, is highly electrical. So that is what this talk will be about. How can we treat people by means of electricity? All right, I have a couple of movies for you, so I hope that the technology will work. The first one will be right after the outline. What I would like to do with you today is first jump to the year 2057. So what will the healthcare system and what will healthcare look like in 2057? And this is not, I have to be honest about, this is not not my vision. It is a vision generated by quite a few people all over the world, and I have to turn it into a movie. Actually, you can find it on YouTube. There are 3 episodes. One is about transport, one is about energy, one is about health. And I took the one about health and I basically re-edited this video to take out the relevant parts to put my presentation in the right perspective. After that, we will, once we know what the future will look like, then we have to, of course, to worry about how can we make that happen. So then we jump back to 2012, we jump back to today, and I will tell you what in my group we are doing on various aspects in medical technology. And I will zoom in onto what we're doing on wearable and implantable medical devices, and mainly on implantable medical devices. So we will be dealing with neurostimulation, with cochlear implants, with neurosensing devices, And I will talk also a little bit about RF energy harvesting. It is a little bit off topic. However, I believe that you can only make implantable devices successful when they successfully can harvest energy from the environment. So that is why I have an activity with three PhD students on RF energy harvesting. One of them, by the way, is André Manzano, that quite a few of you may know. He received his education close by. And then I will draw some conclusions, and then we are ready for the coffee break. Okay, so first we will make the jump to the year 2057. So I hope the sound is working. Basically what you will see there, the main character is Alain Degas. And the story is like this. He went to a party the night before, and on that party he was drinking. But of course drinking is not allowed according to the insurance company. It is an American movie, and you know Americans are very concerned about how much they have to pay on insurance, etc. So you have to understand that he's a little bit tampering with the healthcare system, right? He will not brush his teeth with the ultrasound brush because that will reveal that he has been drinking alcohol the night before. So you have to understand that. And also, when he goes to his work, something goes wrong. And that will give us a glimpse into the future how he will be treated when something happens to him. All right, let's go.
Now with the body.
Fifty years from now, you'll live in an intelligent house. You can program sensors to monitor your body and keep you healthy, yet guard your privacy. Computer chips connect you to the entire city, including your insurance company. The good news is you'll live a lot longer, because an agent gives you a remote physical every 3 days. The bad news? You'll have no secrets.
Wait, mucous membrane of the mouth? Send health memo immediately.
Bonjour, Monsieur Degas. Here are a few more tips for your dental care. Brush your teeth regularly using the ultrasound toothbrush.
This will give away the fact that Alain was partying last night and his premiums will go up as a result.
Thanks for your attention.
You must be joking. Get the car, please.
Alain's clothing looks quite ordinary, but that's deceptive, because woven inside the fabric are dozens of tiny computer chips and sensors monitoring his health. When he puts on his clothing, he goes online. Now get this. If he's ever knocked unconscious, his clothes will automatically identify his coordinates, alert the authorities, and upload his entire medical history before the ambulance arrives. In the future, you will have a doctor in your clothing.
In 2057, your clothes will contain biomedical sensors connected to a global network. The moment a soldier is hit, smart clothes will transmit the exact location of the wound and his vital signs. Smart clothes will monitor carbon monoxide levels for firemen, and they'll alert a hospital at the first signs of a heart attack. In 2057, your car pulls up on command to take you to work. Today, a three-story fall would probably kill you, but not in the future. In a split second, your clothes transmit the severity of your injury.
Insurance status? We have clearance for ambulance. Initiate cause analysis. Alert hospital. Back. Down.
Within 1 minute, help's on the way. It won't get stuck in traffic. It can land anywhere, and it's fast. When you have a severe accident, brain cells can die within 6 minutes. The ambulance of tomorrow will not only reach you in time, it will carry a medical revolution that can save your life.
Patient data registered. Alain Degas. Platinum class confirmed. Loss of blood, 35%. I suggest reversible death.
Okay.
With your body stabilized, you can be loaded into an ambulance and flown to a hospital. The ER of the future will be completely different.
Diagnosis?
Suspended animation, no brain activity, abnormal cardiac function, heavy compound fractures. Contusion of the spine, paraplegia likely.
Not looking good. Okay, let's get started. Insert the sensors.
Tiny electrical microstimulators are injected in your leg and attach themselves to your disabled muscles. The sensors will receive wireless signals that reconnect your muscles with your brain, allowing you to walk again. In the future, health insurance could consume almost a quarter of your salary.
Can you move your leg?
But it provides medical miracles.
Okay, Monsieur Descartes. Now I'll activate the chip in your head.
This single chip will help him walk again.
Let's practice some walking. Monsieur Descartes?
Does a brain chip sound impossible? Think again.
Ready?
Today, there are hundreds of thousands of patients worldwide who are paralyzed. But in the future, we will have a computer chip that connects the brain directly to an arm or a leg, bypassing the injured spinal cord, and the paralyzed will walk again.
Okay, so if you have interest in this movie, it is indeed called 2057 The Body. You will find it on YouTube. It's about 45 minutes long. It gives you an idea what the future will look like. It also, for instance, it also has interviews with scientists all over the world that are really onto these topics. For instance, the car that you saw there, well, that is what they currently are working on. And actually, some prototypes have already been constructed that can really maneuver themselves in space and can be driven like a car. All right, so let's move on. Let's talk a little bit about wearable and implantable medical devices. So these devices are worn on the body in the case of wearable devices, or they are implanted inside the body by a surgeon. And they are there to do three things: either to monitor patient conditions and help with the diagnosis, or to deliver therapy to the patient. Basically, they can act as a sensor and they can act as an actuator. And ideally, that should happen in a closed loop fashion, which nowadays it's not yet the case. And in many cases, they can facilitate or offer an alternative to drug treatment. Here you see a young girl, and apparently she's fed up with the medicine. What we see that now with highly specialized pills, basically with highly specialized drugs, you see that that they have a lot of side effects. They are not always effective. They act globally, not locally. So there's a whole range of pathologies that cannot be treated by means of drugs. And then alternative ways are being sought and found, and very often they are in the form of, electronic devices that somehow interact with the body. Talking a little bit about wearable medical devices, well, there's a whole range of quantities that physiologists have an interest in. For instance, motion, skin temperature, galvanic skin response, and so on. They all can give an indication of the patient's condition and what type of therapy he will need. Here you can see an example of an ECG monitor that's being developed by the Holt Center in the Netherlands. This is PDA, but he is wearing here on his chest, he's wearing kind of a band, and a band that does the ECG recording and also some monitoring of the respiration, and that is then wirelessly being transmitted to this module, and then it is shown on the PDA. Another example is what you already can buy on the market. Actually, this is Vivometrics Live Shirt. I think it's still quite bulky. It's not comfortable to wear, but it already offers, for instance, ECG recording, respiration recording of the respiration by means of a band over here and a band over here. So that gives an indication of the breathing and the motion of the chest. It can also measure a few other things like temperature and pressure. A smaller device that is also available is the SenseWear Pro by Body Media. You basically, it is kind of a an armband that you can wear, and it measures a few body signs. Okay. And of course, for all these types of devices, if you're working on them, you have to understand that they should be comfortable to wear. They should be washable, waterproof, robust. That means that all the electronics need to be included in the fabric. And of course, it should be easy to install, right? And very important, personal and secure. You don't want somebody else to tamper with your shirt. Okay. My idea is that these type of devices ideally should be washable, and then by being washed in the washing machine, being recharged. So that when you put them on again, they are fully energized and they can sustain for at least a day or so. Now moving to implantable medical devices. So now we go into the body. There is already a whole range of sensory devices out there that do things in the body. For instance, there are the so-called Holter recorders. Holter recorder is something you usually wear externally, but you also can have an implantable Holter recorder, and that is being done for people that may suffer from very rare arrhythmia of the heart. So irregularities of the heart pattern that are so rare that they cannot be monitored by, for instance, the cardiologist while you are on site. But so these people can have implanted for a couple of weeks or even a month a small device. It's almost as big as this. It will be implanted here in the chest, close to the heart, and it will do a recording over a certain amount of time, so that later the cardiologist can really look into the phenomena that can, for instance, eventually lead into a lethal condition. The electroneurogram can be recorded, electrocorticogram, so this is coming from the cortex, basically the outer side of your brain. There are implantable glucose sensors. These are not yet perfect, people are still working on them, but of course it's very important to treat diabetes. Intracranial pressure sensors, for instance, people that have suffered from a tumor in the brain that has been removed, they still their brain should be monitored very carefully so that the pressure that occurs in the brain will not be too high, because that will lead to damage of the healthy tissue. Normally that will restore itself, but it needs to be monitored very closely right after the operation. And there are also other types of sensors that are currently already being developed or are available. As an actuator in the body, there is of course the insulin pump. This is a very important device. It is already a very reliable device, so basically it is implanted in the abdomen, and it has a container with insulin, and only on a regular basis, and also controlled by the user, a certain amount of insulin will be released. ICDs, implantable cardio defibrillators, are of course well known. These are devices that basically give a kind of a shock to your heart to reset its condition, so it will start beating in a regular fashion again. Muscle stimulators do exist, and also neurostimulators. Here you see a neurostimulator of ANS. It's actually a pacemaker-like device. In fact, it is not more than a pacemaker, and it is there in many cases to stimulate tissue in the brain to cure some of the pathologies that are brain-related. The only one that I know that really operates in a closed-loop fashion, and I think that all these type of devices for all pathologies should eventually operate in a closed-loop fashion, the only one that does that is the cardiac pacemaker. The cardiac pacemaker is a very clever device. It looks at the incoming ECG. It combines it with all kinds of sensory information, like motion and breathing, and then it decides which therapy to apply to the heart. So no wonder that many of the other type of stimulators basically are trimmed down version of the pacemakers. Okay, so pacemakers and stimulators, they stimulate tissue in order to create an action potential that the body can use, for instance, to contract a muscle, to interact with a neuronal pathway. And basically what you do is there that you need to bring a certain amount of charge into the tissue so that this happens. So let's take a look in neurostimulation. We are working in my group on energy efficient neurostimulation, because currently still a lot of energy is being wasted, and that means that all these kind of stimulating devices have a battery that is much larger than is essentially needed. The energy available in the battery is much more than you need for effective, say, stimulation of your tissue. So a lot of energy is being wasted, and we're working on trying to improve the efficiency. The idea behind it is that basically, well, like I already told, that we believe that now the days of drugs are more or less over, or well, not over, they're stable. There are some developments, they go rather slowly, but really there is a breakthrough in, say, electronic medicine. And why is that? Well, when you interact with the body in an electric fashion, then you will do that very locally. Unlike, for instance, paracetamol that you can use to suppress any pain anywhere in your body, for instance, by means of electronic stimulation, you can suppress pain very locally. The good thing about neurostimulation is also, apart from this local effect, that it is instantaneous. If you turn it on, it immediately works. You don't need time for the drug to become effective. You also do not need time to turn to another dose. You basically you turn it on and off. You can change your therapy, and the effect is immediate. And it's also reversible, as we will see. And currently, these devices, they are very, I would say, medieval. They are very, very, very simple devices. In essence, a neurostimulator is nothing more at the moment than a blinking light in your brain. So you take a blinking light from an old car from Eastern Europe. You put it in your brain, if you can do that, and then it can already do essentially the same type of neurostimulation. So, and because there was not yet much innovation going on in that area, these devices tend to be very bulky still. Here you can see an example of Medtronic. Basically, you see two type of pacemaker-like devices that are implanted in the chest, and from there the wires go under the skin, through the neck, up here to the skull, and then through the skull inside the brain. And for instance, this can be a very effective treatment of Parkinson's disease. But as you can see, there are a lot of disadvantages of such a solution. It's highly invasive. You are required to have at least two surgeries, one for the electrode array and one for the pacemakers themselves. They are connected by means of wires that have a tendency to break, and they start wandering in your body. And if they also have a tendency to attach to your skin, and that can cause pain and discomfort. It's not this guy. Well, you won't see it because it is used in an advertisement of Medtronic. But he very likely has difficulty turning his head, and he's suffering from pain because it does not allow this turning of his head anymore in a natural manner. So, but yet, unlike these disadvantages, the effects can be very impressive. Here you see somebody that's suffering from Parkinson's disease. You can see the tremor. He has difficulty keeping his hands still. He cannot stand up by himself, so he needs to be put in position by the nurse. So there's nothing that he can do himself. You see? And if she would let him go, then he would immediately fall back on the chair. After the surgery, and remember, it is just a blinking light. Here the blinking light is being turned on. You see what he can do? He has full control over his motion. He can grasp things. I'm pretty sure he can grasp my neck. He can stand up by himself. He can walk around. And apparently he's pretty happy with that, because he even gives us a kind of bonus here. He makes a turn. He probably will make a good dancer as well. And this is just because at the right place in the brain, there is with a regular frequency, there is a certain amount of charge being released, causing essentially a kind of a lesion in the brain, which you otherwise would do by means of, for instance, cutting away that piece of the brain. And it leads to this leads to this effect already. All right. What we are working on is trying to make these devices small. So here you can see a kind of, this is what you will find in a typical neurostimulator. What you can see from it is that a large part of the area, I hope you can see it, this is the battery here. So a large part of the area is being, of the volume is being consumed by the battery. And what you also can see, there are a lot of yellow blocks here, these are coupling capacitors. And coupling capacitors are there to guarantee safety, but they also occupy a rather large area. So my idea is to be more efficient with the energy, apply energy harvesting, and get rid of the need of these coupling capacitors. Make the stimulation intrinsically safe without the use of coupling capacitors. And then if you do that, you can go to a solution that is more in this size, which is what the doctors would like to have. They would like to have something that they can implant in the brain and that does not have all these wires attached to a device that is fairly remote. And what I also think will happen in the future, that the loop will be closed by means of applying feedback. It would be good if these type of devices can listen to the brain's natural activity and decide whether to stimulate or not. In the case of epilepsy, for instance, you can see from the brain signals the way they change over time that there is an epileptic insult oncoming. You can use that information to apply therapy. The only problem with epilepsy is it's not a local phenomena, so you need to have more sites in the brain that are being monitored and being stimulated. We're still very far away from that. So this is what we do when we look into this aspect. If we want to make it more efficient, and if we want to make it small enough to be implanted in the brain, then we really have to care about the components. What you see here, this is a solution. This is a principal solution of a current-based neurostimulator circuit, of which we last Monday received the chips back from the foundry. So this is a circuit definition of a current-based neurostimulator circuit that does not need this coupling capacitor. Also, what we really try to do is, you cannot see it here, but you can see it in one of the next slide. Okay, I will show it later. Is that we might try to make a real effort to make the circuit small, because we anticipate that we will need either more of these circuits on a single chip, or that we can combine it with recording modalities and thereby make it so it has to be really small. So we made an effort to make it small on the layout, but also the first winning step basically is by that we get rid of the coupling capacitor. So this is the principle. Of course, there's a lot of electronics around it. We have the switches that need to be special switches. They need to convert a low voltage switching signal into a high voltage switching signal, etc. So there's much more electronics to this than just this circuit. But this is the basic principle that allows safe stimulation. And why is it safe? Because the safety of stimulation is ensured when the amount of charge that you bring in the tissue is also taken out of the tissue, the exact amount. So if you bring in, for instance, 10 nanocoulomb into the brain tissue, you also have to take out 10 nanocoulomb. Of course, by means of a coupling capacitor, you can guarantee that, but you also by means of good electronic design, you can do it. So a current-based neurostimulator, what does it need to have? It needs to have a current source. When it sources, it should have exactly the same value as when it sinks the current. And if you then turn it on for exactly the same time, then you have full control over the charge that is injected in the tissue and released from the tissue. So this is what we did, and we needed a new circuit technique for that. I will not go into the circuit technique, but if you're interested in the circuit technique, please contact me after the presentation or take a look at my website, which the address I will show you at the end of the presentation. So here you can see what is happening. These are the waveforms that are being used. So we use three cycles. First cycle is where we stimulate the tissue. Second cycle is where we release the charge from the tissue again. And then the third cycle, that is the final cycle, where we short circuit the tissue to remove any small residue charge. And this is how you can see that during the first phase, the charge is being built up, and then it stays constant, and then in the second phase the charge is taken away again, and then in this third phase here, and there's a zoom in here, you can see that it goes to asymptotically to a value, and this value is really very close to zero. So that means that it is safe, and we got rid of the coupling capacitor, and we can do that for currently we're working on a 128 channel neural stimulator, so we do not need 128 external capacitors anymore. That will save a lot of area. Okay, so this is the circuit circuit layout. What you can immediately recognize is that if you're dealing with high voltage devices, then these devices tend to be very bulky. So what we did, we tried to make an effort to reduce the amount of high voltage devices to the minimum. So they are still there. All these devices are high voltage devices. The low voltage device, for instance, these are low voltage devices. They are much smaller. And you can combine them also more easily. All right. Let's move on to another topic, cochlear implants. So cochlear implants are devices to enable people that are deaf, that are usually when they are born deaf or they have become deaf after an infection or after an incident, to allow them to hear again. There are three major industrial players, and in 2012, it is estimated that about 230,000 people are wearing a cochlear implant worldwide. I collaborate with a medical doctor at the Leiden University Medical Center, and he does most of the implants for the Netherlands. And it's very impressive to see the effects of once a cochlear implant has been implanted, and a week later it is turned on for the first time. And this is what we will see.
Here we go, it's coming back on.
Wait a minute, I have to stop it here. First I need to tell. So what's happening, this is this young child has been implanted a cochlear implant. A week after the surgery, once the tissue has recovered, etc., then he's being connected. So they will then start to stimulate for the first time the auditory nerve via the cochlea. So it is a cochlear implant, it goes into the cochlea, that's the part where mechanical movement is turned into electrical signals. So now it is the cochlea is stimulated electrically, and this is the first time that the child will perceive a sound. Okay, so you can witness that.
Here we go, it's coming back on, and he's back on again. See how he turns?
Turn. Hi, Jonathan.
Stop the sucking.
Yeah. Hi.
Good.
Could you hear that? Hi, okay. Sweetie. Could you hear that? Hi. Hi.
You got that, Dad, right?
Mm-hmm. Hi, Jonathan.
All right. So that is a little wonder, I think. But if you look what technology takes, I think this technology is very bulky. Look at it. So this is the part that makes a connection through the skin to the implantable part of the cochlear implant. But there is also an external part. So this is type of a hearing instrument like device. It's connected to an external processor so that she's wearing on her chest. Then it comes back again. And it goes to this coil here that makes an inductive link to the inside, and that is where the actual stimulation takes place. So if you look at it, I think that the challenge clearly is to make it small. And if you look at what universities are doing there, for instance, the group of Kendall Weiss, he's trying to create a bionic ear that really fits completely in the patient. And this is the first. This is one of the attempts that he did. So he made a chip that has all the processing. So the thing that was here in this externally worn device is now put into this chip. And then, by means of a flexible PCB, it goes to an electrode array over here. So this is where it really happens. This is the part that goes into the cochlea, and the cochlea is really a very tiny device. This is about half a centimeter. Right, and it does not grow after you're half a year old. So it's about half a centimeter, and you have to put an electrode array in there. And if you asked the audiologist or the people working from the medical perspective, they would like to have 230 channels to stimulate properly. Currently, by the way, it looked as if the child was really hearing his mother and that he could completely understand her. This is not the case. He probably would also laugh at her when she was just making some movements with her mouth. Because after all, it's his mother, right? So children laugh at their parents. And the sounds that he probably perceived sounded something like this. Okay, I'm now trying to do something that is dangerous. I'm trying to make an imitation of how we, by means of reconstruction, understand the type of sound that he perceives. It goes like this. Hi, Jonathan. Suckings, suckings. You hear that? So there is no tonal information. It is more kind of modulated noise. And for many of these patients, when, for instance, when they are confronted with music, it sounds awful. They cannot appreciate music at all because it is really just painful noise in their brain that they cannot turn on. Also, I have in my group, I have two PhD students from Thailand. The Thai language is a tonal language. It has 7 intonations, if I'm not mistaken. That means that if you do not have this tonal information, you cannot understand what is being said. The Western languages, they do not have tonal information, so even if I speak like a robot, you still can understand me, right? But not in the Thai language, because the way you do your intonation can change the meaning. So they are, of course, very dedicated to change that. We are trying to work on algorithms, but also on the circuitry to hopefully in the future be able to allow these people to have a more natural perception of sound and enjoy music. Okay, so where is the problem? Well, the problem is the fact that we want to be here, right? So here this is a flexible PCB, but it can only have a couple of wires, say 8 or 16. Definitely not the 230 that the medical doctors would like to have. So what is needed? More electrodes for accurate stimulation of the nerve fibers, and we need to understand that the available area in the cochlea is very small, and this really puts a limit on the size of your chip, not because of cost, because it simply does not fit in the cochlea. So our idea is to put the chip into the cochlea, create the electrodes and the electronics together on the chip. And here you can see a first attempt. This is just the electrode array on silicon. We use here silicon nitride to create these electrodes. And by means of IC technology, we are able to at least solve the wiring problem. And the next step will be that we try to bring here the stimulating circuitry and also recording circuitry. We try to bring it here between the electrodes or under the electrodes. Of course, you can understand that here you also cannot tolerate external capacitors, right? Okay, so another challenge for cochlear implants is also do some recording, and it's very important during the operation. So you need to know how well contact is made in the cochlea. So what they do, they stimulate on one side and they listen to the neural response. But of course, that is there is a huge dynamic range problem, because you may stimulate with voltages up to 20 volts and you are interested in the recording of signals that can be as small as 10 microvolts. So currently we are working on electronics to do this readout, and we need to have a different type of analog to digital converter for that. It has to be, of course, low power, but also it should be more tailored to the type of signal that we're dealing with. So 2 days ago I gave a presentation on the principle of instantaneous compounding, and this is what we want to do. We want to take the signal, reduce it in size, but not by just dividing it by a constant, but by basically dividing it in regions. And I will show that. And that is the principle of a level crossing analog to digital converter. It is much more tailored to the type of signals that we're dealing with. So this is the principle of a level crossing A to D converter. So what does it do? Here is the input signal. It just waits until it reaches a particular level with respect to that input signal. So for instance, you can see it here. If this is not very clear, but if you look at this line here, this is a signal, and you see that there are two thresholds, and these two thresholds, when they are crossed, then basically an up or down signal is being generated. And this is the operation principle of such a level crossing A to D. If you look at it, what is striking is that you see that here, to make it happen, they use an n-bit D2A converter, whereas the information that they process is only 1 bit, right? If it reaches a level, it basically enters another region, and that is 1 bit information. Why do I need an n-bit DAC for that, right? That's also basically the question behind the sigma delta converter. So what we did, and we said, okay, let's make a 1-bit DAC here, that uses charge redistribution, and let's do an operation on the input signal itself. And we can do that in a passive way. So what we do, we have a capacitor array there that takes in the signal, and every time a level is crossed, we offset the signal by a well-defined amount, and we bring it back into the range that we are working with. And by this, we can capture a 20-volt signal with all its details and bring it within, for instance, a 1-volt range and process it further in low-voltage technology. And low-voltage is important because low-voltage devices are much smaller than the high-voltage devices, as you could see from the layout of the stimulator circuit. All right, so this is the basic idea. We take in the signal by means of a capacitor array. Once a level crossing is being detected, then by means of connecting this to a high, this node to a high or to a low, we basically update the state of the capacitor array and thereby bring back the signal within the range where we operate on. And this is usually the type of signals that we can get out of it. So here you have a sinusoidal excitation in the differential form in this case, and it basically, when it crosses a level, then immediately goes back, and then when it crosses the same level again, it goes back, and this is how we basically divide the sinusoid into portions without losing details, for instance, that may be present on the sinusoid. And if you do that, you can by understanding that you are really processing just one bit information at a time, and by also some better circuit design, you can really bring down the power consumption, and most importantly, you can really take in a signal that exceeds the supply voltage. Okay, how am I doing with the time, Sander? Okay. I think I will make that. So let's move to neurosensing devices. So we have talked about stimulating. Let's talk about neurosensing devices. So let's first talk about tinnitus. Tinnitus, I'm pretty sure that quite a few in the room, they experience tinnitus. Tinnitus is a phantom sound. It is a sound that you hear that is not actually there, and it is generated by the brain. And basically, it's due to a reconstruction of the auditory cortex. So you have the part of the brain that perceives sound, and it gets a different structure just because the brain trains itself in a different manner, and at some point it may start generating sounds. And it can be, for instance, due to damage in your middle ear. It can be to a very loud sound. So for this reason, it is important to wear earplugs when you go to a discotheque, because you will be more sensitive to developing tinnitus also at a later age when you have loss of hearing. So it is the perception of sound without a corresponding external sound. It is about 1 out of 10 people that may experience tinnitus, but in 2 to 3% of the cases, tinnitus can really lead to very nasty side effects like insomnia, anxiety, depression, and there is a whole lot of, say, joy is just lost, but also a lot of workforce is lost because of these people that suffer from tinnitus. So there are not really proven treatments for tinnitus. People are trying to help with drugs in some case that works. Some patients, however, may benefit from electrical brain stimulation. So first what you do, of course, you try the drug method because that is not invasive. But if people are really in great pain, and there are, for instance, Professor Dirk de Ridder that I worked with last year, he lost 6 patients who committed suicide because they were in so much pain. So it can be a very cruel disease. Some patients, they may benefit from electrical brain stimulation. It's about 50% of the patients that cannot be treated by means of drugs. So how does it work? Well, you basically, when you implant an electrode array in the you bring an electrode array on the auditory cortex and you stimulate there. But you have to find the right site to stimulate. So you have an electrode array, but you still have to find out which electrode to stimulate. And also you have to find the right pattern to stimulate. So this requires a lot of trial and error. And every time the patient is asked, okay, how is your tinnitus now? How is your tinnitus now? Do you feel depressed? And you know, after a lot of questioning and answering, the patient gets bored and he starts to gradually deviate from his objective perception. He says, yeah, I think it works. He wants to go home. I think it works. Yeah, it's fine now. Okay, yeah, you leave it to them. So what is needed is an objective measure of the amount of tinnitus that somebody experienced. While the electrodes are there, you can do recording as well. And it was found out by among others, Dirk de Ridder, it was found out I will show that later, you can really identify some difference in the waveforms that are generated on the tinnitus side. So there where the tinnitus is, and thus where the treatment should happen. So I believe that in the future we should have an automatic tinnitus detector, because tinnitus can also change over time, and then you have to readjust your therapy. But I think that in the future there will be an automatic tinnitus detector. And how can you do that? Well, the tinnitus site, so the part where you develop tinnitus in your brain, has different waveforms. And these waveforms have a different frequency content. So for instance, normal brain tissue has a lot of alpha waves. So the blue wave is the normal, the frequencies. So this is an energy spectrum. And normal brain tissue has a lot of alpha waves, whereas, tinnitus tissue has lower alpha, but higher theta and higher gamma. So what you can do is that you can devise an algorithm, and this is the algorithm. You just look at the energy in the various bands, and you compare it from various sites. And then you can say, oh, this site has tinnitus and this one does not have tinnitus. So this is the algorithm that you can develop. It's very simple. And of course, the question is, can you also make it with a very very small and power efficient electronics? And yes, you can. And we have done that. And here you can see that at the moment that all this the alpha, you can see, for instance, at the moment here that the theta of the that is generated at the tissue site becomes higher than what is generated at the healthy site, then in combination with all the other frequencies, then tinnitus is being detected, so it works, and we were able to devise a relatively simple circuit that only consumes 60 nanowatt. And if you do that, then indeed you can put a large electrode array in the brain and to make a low power detection possible and thus make the treatment more effective. So our idea is, and we're currently working on that in Delft, we basically have started up this, is that we will design a flexible cortical implant, basically a kind of foil that will be overlaid over the auditory cortex. We want it to serve as a platform for various type of implantables, because if you can do it at the auditory cortex, you can also do it at the visual cortex. And you can also do it at other sites where other type of brain-related diseases occur. We want to use a polymer as a substrate for that, a biocompatible polymer. Silicon can be a base material then on that polymer. So we use certain grains of silicon on that polymer. The polymer is there to create a wide area so that we can reach multiple sites on the brain. Silicon is used as a base material for the electrodes, for instance using silicon nitride, for the electronic circuits, for the battery foil. We also have an activity in Delft where silicon is a base material for the battery foils, and you can also use silicon for the antennas. And then you have basically all the goodies that are needed for such an implantable device, which is stretchable and flexible. How am I doing? Because I have one more topic. Well, let me ask the audience, do you have time for one more topic? That's about 10 more minutes. This is about energy harvesting. And energy harvesting, of course, is not only interesting from a medical perspective, it can also be important for RFID. And I have two important messages for you. And hopefully you can improve your energy harvesting activities with the things that I can show you here. So bear with me. Sorry to take a little bit time off your coffee break. Okay. So energy harvesting, what is it? You want to collect energy from the environment. But currently, you see that all the energy harvesters that are around, they usually do with around minus 20 to minus 25 dBm. In a realistic environment, that is not the case. Here in this room, we do not have this minus 20 dBm. If you do measurements, and these are measurements that I found that were conducted in various environments. For instance, on a roadway, a non-commercial roadway, residential area, highway, campus, etc. So if you just sniff the energy that is in the air, then you usually find values that are not in this area, but they're more in this area. And the question is, how can we make energy harvesters that can be successfully start harvesting energy while the energy levels are below minus 25 dBm? It is possible. That's the good news. So what you would the challenges are, you would like to have robustness against the environment, power level, and process variations. We have to understand that if the environment changes, then also the environment of the antenna changes. So that means that the antenna itself changes. So the electrical properties of the antenna and the electromagnetic properties of the antenna, they change. We have to also understand that the rectifier input impedance is nonlinear. People tend to talk about impedance, but it's not really an impedance. Impedance is something that works in the small signal domain, right? So impedance is not the right term there, but yeah, people try, they would like to see an impedance there, and then the first thing they do is impedance matching. That's not the right thing to do. I will show you why. And of course, then they will have difficulty to obtain a good conjugate impedance match, right? First of all, it's not an impedance, and your antenna also changes. So where's the match? And as a result of that, they can only cover a limited wireless range. So let's see whether we can improve on that, okay? This is some work that I did together with André Manzano. The idea behind this is that we say, in an energy harvester, we usually have two types of paths. Basically, it's a philosophical question that we ask. Why do these paths have to be the same? What are the two paths? The path is the energy path, and there is the signal path, the clocking path, right? If you have a diode is a self-clocking switch, right? Of course, we know that diodes have some nasty effects, like there's a voltage drop across them. So people are looking into use, for instance, MOS switches, because they allow for a smaller voltage drop. These MOS switches need to be switched. So that means you need a switching signal. Why does the energy signal has to be the same as the switching signal? So this is what we do. We have a voltage boosting network over here, and we generate two types of signals. We generate the energy path here, which is the energy, which is at a relatively lower impedance level, if you want. And we generate a clock signal that is there to turn on the switches and turn on effectively, so it has to have a higher amplitude. So this is what we do. So we use the CMOS transistors as switches. We capacitively couple, but these capacitors can be relatively small, so they will not occupy a large chip area. We can capacitively couple the clocking signal, and we superimpose it onto a value, and we take it from a part in the resonating circuit where the voltage levels are higher. So this point is being used for the clocking, and this point is used for the energy. Okay? And when we do that, you can see this work. I have to make a small disclaimer. This is still simulated, but we're quite confident because we are using technology which has really good models, and we even tried it over various technologies. So it is simulated and not yet measured. But what you can see is that with a limited number of stages, in standard CMOS technology, we can have higher output voltages, and we can, most importantly, have a higher power efficiency. And here you see how it is specified for various loads, but we can really get a higher efficiency out of it. Okay, so that's one thing, to make to decouple the signal and the energy path. A second approach that you can do is that you understand what would be the ideal loading of my antenna. Well, by understanding that the rectifier usually is loaded by a capacitor, especially if you are in a low energy environment, you first need to harvest a lot of energy, harvest a lot of charge. So how do you effectively bring charge on a capacitor? By driving it with a current. So that means you would like to extract a current out of your antenna. And that's good, because if you create a short circuit here at this point, you basically get the maximum amount of power out of your antenna. By making a conjugate match, you will get only half the power out of your antenna, and the antenna will basically, will throw away the other 50%, right? So we will create not a power match at this point. No, we will create a short circuit by means of a circuit at this point. By this, we get most of the energy out of the antenna. And that energy then needs to be relayed onto the capacitor by means of the rectifier. So when you do that, and when I call it optimal mismatch, because you basically you match the antenna impedance to a low impedance, then you get most of the energy out of that. So this is the circuit that that we developed for that. Of course, you need something like a resonating network to really create this 0 ohms that is loading the antenna. We need to have some tuning, so that's why you see these switching capacitors. We select the right capacitance value. At the resonant frequency, we are able to extract more energy from the antenna. And when you do that, and then you get these results, here you see the output voltage. So this is the output voltage in millivolt. This is 1 volt, this is 2 volt. This is the input power level in dBm. We have minus 20 here, minus 25 over here. So basically this is right from this is where all the other designs are functional, and you see they all break down. They cannot work below minus 25. Yeah, there's one exception that we found in literature, but it uses an awful lot of stages and has a very bad power efficiency. Our detector starts from minus 45 dBm and is already able then to create half a volt there. And with minus 40, we're close to 1 volt already. And there's none of the energy harvesters that can do that. And the idea behind it is just because we understood we should load the antenna, we should select a low impedance antenna, because then we can get a lot of energy out of it, and we should load it with a short circuit, thus create a short circuit by our rectifier and the resonator in front of it. So this is the layout that we generated. Also, although it is realized in a different technology, also this came back last week, so we do not yet have the measurement results. We have prepared the PCB, so I hope we can report on these results very soon. But I'm quite optimistic that the principle will work. Conclusions. So, I gave you a glimpse of the activities that we are doing in the biomedical electronics at TU Delft. Our idea is that we work on better monitoring, diagnosis, and treatment by means of electricity. I gave you some examples of that. In the area of neurostimulation, we really want to make it small and energy efficient. We have also other types of activities on the efficiency, but I showed you one. Cochlear implants, there the challenge is really not only to stimulate, but also be able to read out the signal that comes from the read out the neural response. That is very important for the fitting of the cochlear implant into the cochlea. But I think in the future, it will also be important to adjust the therapy over time, so that you can apply it in a closed-loop fashion. We looked at neurosensing devices, and hopefully by means of this foil, this polymer with silicon grains on top of it that are connected, we can contribute to the treatment of a whole range of brain-related disorders. And I talked a little bit about energy harvesting, where there are two lessons to be learned. You can split the power at the switching path, and you can create an optimal mismatch and thereby have a much better efficiency of your energy harvester. So, thank you very much for your attention. There's one more message that I would like to make. Thanks, of course, also for Sandro for inviting me. I would like to thank the members of my group. You see a couple of them over here. André, by the way, was not available at that time, so he was not on the photo. There's one more message that I would like to make. Next year, we will organize BioCast 2013 in Rotterdam. It is organized by Delft University of Technology and IMEC in Belgium, but it will be in Rotterdam. So if you have contributions that you would like to make, the paper deadline will be in June next year, and the conference itself, like it says, will be at the end of October. So I hope that I will see you there. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Walter, for this very interesting talk. I think we have time for a few questions.
I agree, it was very interesting. I got a million questions.
Million questions, okay.
Million questions.
I don't think we have time for that. But
apart from the microphone, I'm not sure if it works. I'll pick one. You were talking about cochlear implants, and you mentioned that they're not effective for either music or tonal languages. If I remember well, in a cochlea, the location of the hair cells basically determines for which frequency they are sensitive.
Correct.
So, in effect, it performs an audio
Fourier transform.
You mentioned wanting more channels. Are you going to use these additional channels for an FFT that you perform electrically?
Well, there are two things important. Yeah, you're right. Indeed, what is done in the cochlea is a kind of a space to frequency to space transformation, and then space is then coded electrically, so that indeed the various neuronal pathways have different frequency information. That is correct. There are two things that currently go wrong in cochlear implants. First of all, they only can make contact effectively, say, at 8 sites. So that means that basically all frequency information is compressed into 8 frequencies. So that's not enough for appreciation of music, and it's not enough for tonal languages. And another thing that goes wrong is what they call the scanning. They scan every frequency at a time. So they stimulate every frequency one after the other. And important time information, I forgot the name, the fine structure, yes. They call it fine structure information is lost. So it is the type of stimulation by means of the scanning that basically is responsible for a large portion of this. So we need to solve two things. We need to develop a stimulation strategy that can allow for simultaneous stimulation of hair cells, and we need more electrodes to have more frequencies available.
Okay.
And the rest of the million questions I am happy to receive later.
Perhaps two more questions, so, and then we go for.
While the sensor is implanted in the body, what's the source of harvesting energy?
Can basically be anything. You have to understand that the propagation through the body becomes worse when frequency increases. Effective energy propagation into the body is possible below 1 gigahertz. And it basically can be anything, but yeah, what I foresee, because you know, even these power levels are still, what I foresee is that to have reliable harvesting, you probably would like to put a beacon somewhere in your personal space. Maybe it can, for instance, be your cell phone. Everybody is wearing a cell phone. Why isn't the cell phone just transmitting some energy? Well, in fact, it is doing that. It's maintaining contact with the base station. I can use that energy.
Oh, nice.
And I can power some sensory devices from that energy. Currently, the energy harvesters are not sensitive enough to that, but it is possible. It's well defined at a frequency, and I can use that. If I can add to that, it's also an interesting thought, right? Some places in or on your body are more accessible or can tolerate more volume than others. We can use that. I can have a small implantable device that really needs to be small. I don't want it to obstruct with anything else, but it can link to to a place where I have more space available. For instance, here. Does that answer your question?
Okay.
Last question.
Thank you for your presentation. So I'd like to make a question regarding the energy harvester. So when you said that you are using a totally unmatched antenna,
yep,
presented a short circuit to that. So departing from an available power, so we know that we have the highest power transfer to the circuit when you have conjugated matched. So when you present a short circuit, so most of the total power is being sent back to the wire.
Yeah, that's true, yeah, but we don't want power, we want current, right? We want to charge a capacitor. And the best way of charging a capacitor is by means of a current, so we try to get the most current out of that. So, and then we collect more energy in total. But yeah, you're right, yeah. So some power will be reflected back to the antenna, but still we collect more.
Yes.
Yeah, so it is not kind of what also the tests that we plan to do is not only on the harvester, because this is very often being done by people, that they attach the energy harvester to a source, an electrical source, and then they specify the energy power efficiency. That's not what we are going to do. We have also designed an antenna, antenna of which the area is about 2 by 4 centimeters. And this is, and we will first characterize the antenna completely, then attach, we mount the chip directly on the antenna, so there's no 50 ohm in between, etc. You know that. There are other problems with 50 ohm. We mount the IC on the antenna, and then we characterize that combination as a whole. So then we know how much energy falls on top of the antenna and is being converted. And I think that is a much better way of characterizing than just do the characterization in the electrical domain. Because yeah, you're right, energy may be backscattered, the environment may change, but we need to take that into account.
Yes.
Okay.
We'll get later.
Once again, thank you very much, Walter.
Okay, thank you.